Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Allbaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Allbaugh.
Good morning across the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. I'm Todd Allbaugh. It is Monday, May 1st, 2023. Welcome into another work week and back to school, along with our engineer and producer, Mr. Aaron Zomers. Mr. Zomers, how in the heck was your weekend?
It was pretty good. I spent some time mostly at home because the weather was not great.
Right? Not so great, yeah.
And right now, because it is Star Wars week, you know, what with May the 4th be with you.
Yes.
And Return of the Jedi is in theaters for its 40th anniversary. My roommate and I are going to go see it in theaters. So we just finished catching up, watching the rest of the series up till then. So we watched Empire Strikes Back last night.
Fantastic. You cannot go wrong with Empire Strikes Back on a blustery night. Yeah, you're right. It is. One of the finest movies made, I would say. Just really,
I would agree.
Really well done, George Lucas. Fantastic job. Well, great. I stayed in most of the weekend as well on Saturday. I just kind of stayed in, worked on the show a little bit and did a little housework. And yesterday, Mom was in town, so I went out to lunch. And she was looking for a couple of clothing items, and so I went with her. And sadly, she did not find what she was looking for. I, however, found a couple of sales. So I ended up buying a pair of pants and a couple of shirts.
Nice.
So, yeah. Did a little shopping.
By the way, quick note. Empire Strikes Back is actually the only one in the original six movies that George Lucas did not direct.
He wrote it, though, right?
He did, and he still produced it.
Yeah, but who was it that directed Empire Strikes Back? I forget. Well, that's fine. We can dial it up a little bit later. But, there you go, a little trivia for you on...
Yeah, it is Irvin Kershner.
Irvin Kershner. We all know so very well. No, I don't know. Never heard of the guy,
me
really,
either.
Right? But first and foremost, Mr. Zomers, we looked at the calendar, had to flip the page over today because it is May 1st.
Guess what? It's going to be May.
We're going to play that relentlessly throughout the entire 3 hours. No. Just by here and there. A little Justin Timberlake. And it's not going to be May. Now it is May.
Yeah, as we talked about before the show started, what we really should have done is play this relentlessly on Friday. But
are we that organized? No, we are not. Not
sometimes,
yet. We're getting there, but not yet. Sometimes, yes. But yeah, Justin Timberlake, of course, it's going to be May. And then that was kind of a whole Saturday Night Live sketch for a long time, an ongoing joke on Saturday Night Live. So, of course, we're nothing if not up for a... drawing out overused jokes. So yeah, we'll play a little Justin Timberlake this morning. It does not feel like May in many parts of Wisconsin. Up north, we're going to have the complete weather forecast details for you from our meteorologist from Weatherology, Kara Foster, at the bottom of the hour. But I will spoil the forecast and tell you it's cold today. And in fact, the reports are in from Dad up in Shawano, where it is snowing up there. Parts of the Fox Valley are under a winter weather advisory. Farther north, a winter storm warning. Some parts of the state could see several inches of snow. Kind of in the Rhinelander area and that area, I believe. But also, maybe 1 or 2 inches of snow. Oshkosh, Sheboygan, Green Bay. So roads are going to be slushy today. In most of the western side of the Wisconsin, it looks like rain and some snow showers. But no major accumulations. So they say April showers bring May flowers. Well, it brought snow showers. Anyway, it's not feeling like the 1st of May, certainly up in parts of northern Wisconsin this morning.
But we should expect that at this point.
We should expect that, exactly. Kara Foster.
You know, we just got to eagerly await that global warning, that global warming that Ron Johnson, you know, warming globes is good. I don't know why we wouldn't take comfort in this.
Right, I thought it was going to warm up, Ron. Palm trees sprouting everywhere. No, not the case. Question for you this morning, since it is May Day, we're going to talk a little bit about the history of May Day later on this morning. And the question this hour is, do you feel you make enough money? Are you being paid well enough? And if you're an employer, are you paying too much? How do you feel about workers' pay? Because that's kind of an anniversary as well on May Day. It's been used by many folks to talk about workers' rights and pay. But we'll look at both sides of the coin. If you're a worker, are you being paid enough? And if your employer, are you paying too much for labor? 715-388-7155. Again, 715-388-7155. I'd like to hear about your... And again, people are going to be... You might not want to call up because you're afraid your employer is listening. So it doesn't necessarily have to be about you. But in general, do you feel that workers are being paid enough? And in general, do you feel that employers are paying too much? Because I've been on both sides of the coin. So we'll talk about that a little bit later this hour. First of all, here is your weather forecast in brief for today in Richland Center. Breezy, a slight chance of rain and snow, and then a chance of showers later on. A high of 50 degrees in Richland Center. No major accumulation expected, but you could see a snowflake in the air. Decreasing clouds tonight, breezy, a low of 36. And tomorrow, partly sunny and breezy, a high of 53 degrees. Up in Wausau, WXCO, Bull Falls Radio, a 40% chance of rain and snow today. Windy as well, gusts as high as 39 miles per hour. Again, no major accumulations, maybe, you know, a quarter inch here on the grass here and there, but nothing major in Wausau. For tonight, cloudy, breezy, then mostly cloudy, a low of 32. And for tomorrow, Tuesday, mostly cloudy and a high of 44. Over in Amory, WLAK, Lake Air Radio today, mostly cloudy and breezy, a high of 50 degrees. For tonight, cloudy, breezy, then clearing off at a low of 33. And tomorrow, sunny skies in Amory, breezy, and a high of 55 degrees. We'll come back and tell you what you need to know, your news headlines today, talk about May Day as well. Also, Joe Biden's correspondence dinner, all that more on the Todd Allbaugh Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Todd Allbaugh Show. It is now 8:15 on a Monday morning, May 1st, 2023, although it does not feel particularly like May this morning. It will warm up. Kara Foster will be in here at the bottom of the hour with our complete weather forecast details. I can tell you spring is, in fact, on the way.
Eventually, it's going to be May.
Absolutely. It will be May. In fact, we may hit 70 degrees by the weekend. So look forward to that. Just get through the first couple of days of the week here. Weather will continually improve. We'll have sunny skies, warm temperatures on Saturday and Sunday. Or at least so says the forecast. We shall see. Here are your news headlines, what you need to know on May 1st, 2023 at 8:16 on the Civic Media Radio Network. Bank failure. J.P. Morgan Chase is buying most assets of First Republic Bank in a deal announced today after the bank became the third in the U.S. to fail since March. J.P. Morgan said it had acquired, quote, the substantial majority of assets and assumed the deposits insured and uninsured of First Republic from the FDIC, the independent government agency that insures deposits for bank customers. It made the lender the second largest bank failure in the nation's history. The move represents the latest effort by federal regulators to prop up consumer confidence in the banking system, which has now suffered three major bank failures in the last six weeks. First Republic Bank's 84 offices in eight states are set to reopen as branches of J.P. Morgan Chase Bank today during normal business hours, according to the agency. Texas now. More than 250 officers from multiple law enforcement agencies are searching for the gunman accused of shooting and killing five people, including a young child, at a Cleveland, Texas home after neighbors asked him to stop firing his rifle outdoors. The father of the child, that is, told CNN that he and two others walked over to the suspect's home to ask that he shoot his gun on the other side of his yard because the gunfire was making his baby cry. However, the suspect refused, charged into their home, and opened fire. He then fled the scene without leaving a trace, according to officials. An $80,000 reward is being offered for information that leads to the 38-year-old suspect's arrest. The U.S. has suffered at least 184 mass shootings in the first 4 months of this year, according to the Gun Violence Archive. A sidebar note here, a little analysis, if I may. When this first happened over the weekend, Republican Governor of Texas Greg Abbott put out a statement calling the individual killed illegal aliens or illegal immigrants, quote unquote. Didn't refer to them as people, as this news story did. Simply as illegal immigrants. One of those killed was an 8-year-old boy. He had brothers and sisters who did not die because their mom laid on top of them to shield them. She's dead. Her children survived, those two. The 8-year-old boy dead. A guy's firing an AR-15 in the evening, so much so that it's waking up kids trying to sleep. Neighbor just goes over, knocks on the door, and says, hey, can you knock it off? Or at least, he didn't even ask him to knock it off. Said, can you go on the other side of your house? Just move to the other side of your house, man. My kid's trying to sleep. And this whack job goes off, charges the guy's house, and kills his family. That's where we're at today in America. Ukraine now. Russia lost a fresh ground of deadly missile, launched, that is, a fresh round of deadly missile attacks on Ukraine today, resulting in an unspecified number of casualties. This comes as Ukrainian officials are signaling that their much-anticipated counteroffensive could be launched immediately while Russia continues to build up its layers of defense. Meanwhile, the head of the Russian private military company, Wagner, has threatened to withdraw its mercenaries from the embattled city of Bakhmut if they don't receive more supplies from Moscow. Wagner's ongoing clash with Russian generals and other defense officials are ramping up, even as the group continues to recruit hundreds of Russian convicts from prisons to bolster their forces in the region. Sudan. Thousands of foreign nationals have left Sudan since fighting erupted between rival military forces more than 2 weeks ago. While many Sudanese remain stuck in the deteriorating conditions, the violence between the Sudanese armed forces and the Rapid Support Forces paramilitary group that broke out earlier this month has left hundreds dead, including two Americans. The country remains at risk of a humanitarian disaster as those still trapped in their homes face shortages of food, water, medicine, and electricity. Despite a number of nations evacuating their citizens, the United States had maintained for more than a week that the conditions were not conducive to a civilian evacuation. But State Department spokesman Matthew Miller said in a statement Sunday that the U.S. has now, quote, facilitated the departure of nearly 1,000 U.S. citizens from Sudan with cooperation from global allies. And across the pond, the coronation. Following the death of Queen Elizabeth II, her eldest son, Charles III, instantly became king. In the days that followed, he was formally proclaimed Britain's new monarch. And now, after months of painstaking preparation, his coronation is nearly upon us. Heir to the throne for 70 years. 70 years. I mean, if nothing else, the guy has patience, right? I mean, oh, you'll just wait your turn. Charles will be officially crowned in a magnificent and deeply religious ceremony on Saturday, not to mention pricey, alongside his wife, Camilla, Britain's new queen. Thousands will gather at Westminster Abbey and the surrounding streets of central London to witness the public celebration. Buckingham Palace has said, quote, it will reflect the monarch's role today and look forward to the future while being rooted in longstanding traditions and pageantry. I got to say, I watched a lot of news over the weekend, and I saw these stories of this upcoming coronation. And, you know, I've always been fascinated by the royals. A lot of it was Queen Elizabeth, I think, because she was old enough that she was born and became queen when that was still a big thing. And it was kind of like, oh, that's kind of sweet. It kind of ties the past with the present. But now you got King Charles, and it doesn't do the same thing for me. Now I kind of look at it as gaudy and like, really? I mean, it would have been so much cooler had William or Harry become king, because they wouldn't have done all this, you know, pageantry and costumes. They would have been much more chill about it.
Yeah, they definitely would have. It's, I don't even know what to say about the royal family in the UK. Like, they're irrelevant now.
Yeah, I mean, I get it for many Britons, you know, in the UK, it's a big deal. It's their history. It's their culture to a certain degree. I also know I worked with a dual citizen in my previous job. Her dad is a British citizen from the UK. She was, I believe, born there. I'm not sure, but her mom is American. So she has dual citizenship. And she says, you know, she loved Queen Elizabeth, can't stand Charles or Camilla. just not into them at all. And there's a lot of people there that are,
yeah,
that
I think, like that. I think that's reflective of the general opinion that people have across the world.
Right. I mean, I get it. I get it. It's a part of your history, whatever. I think Americans have been enamored by it for years because, of course, we don't have a king. I mean, the closest thing we have to royalty is whomever the president or vice president of the United States is. And it's a very different role, right? There's certainly pageantry involved with being president and vice president, but nothing like there is in the UK.
That's very intentional, though,
with right.
the way the country's set up.
Right.
Although, I would say the closest thing we have to royalty, I mean, there's the president, but there's also, like, I don't know, Jeff Bezos, Elon Musk, the people who just have so much money that they can do anything they want.
True, but I mean, I don't think that, I mean, they don't appear, if anything, they're reclusive. They don't appear in parades or in public or things like that. I think the charm, and again, just talking to a couple of people I've known who are British over the years, citizens of the UK, I think part of the charm of the Queen was that she was seen as kind and polite, and she liked everybody, and she was kind of a goodwill ambassador, you know, so to speak. And not to say there weren't a lot of problems in the royal family under Queen Elizabeth, but most British citizens looked at Queen Elizabeth as someone who had their best intentions at heart. And I think they look at King Charles now and Camilla, and they don't quite see that. I'll simply leave it at that. Right. I'm not here to beat up on anybody, but I did think it was funny. Remember a month or so ago when it came out that King Charles had invited Joe Biden, president of the United States, to the coronation, and he politely said, I'm sending, I believe, Vice President Kamala Harris is going, I believe. But, you know, there's a reason that a president of the United States wouldn't attend the coronation for, you know, the British king. We had a little spat that settled that over 200 years ago. You know, Americans don't particularly like a king.
Yeah, but that was over 200 years ago.
It's still too soon for a lot of people. Too soon. So, yeah. Anyway, that's Saturday. I don't know. If I'm not doing anything else, maybe I'll watch it for 5 or 10 minutes just for history's sake. But I have no plans to sit there and watch the entire thing. Do you?
No. Were are you surprised to hear that, though?
No, not at all.
Although I did see the royal family.
Did you really?
In person, from afar.
When did you see the royal family?
When I was in London. It was on the Queen's official birthday. Not her real birthday, but her official birthday.
Mm-hmm.
The one they celebrate and have an RAF flyover and stuff.
Wow. Were they on the balcony at Buckingham Palace or whatever?
Yep.
Really? Wow, the things I've learned about fancy. Mr. Zommers in a couple of days here. were they waving during the polite wave?
Oh, you know they were.
Really? Who all was on the balcony? Do you remember?
Not totally. I mean, I remember.
Queen.
I remember the Queen was, and that was all that I really cared to remember.
Exactly. He didn't care about anybody else.
I mean, I don't really care too much about royalty, and it was cool to see.
Right.
And especially the Queen.
And nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that. Speaking of our royalty, President Joe Biden has agreed. Again, it doesn't matter who it is. The presidency is as close as we get here. It was the White House Correspondents' Dinner last night in Washington, D.C. And over the years, sometimes it's a hit, sometimes it's a miss. It's where the president is there. They pick a comedian to be the host. And many of the Washington, D.C. media types and politicians show up. It's all for charity. They raise money for charity. And it's a night to roast the president, whoever the sitting president is. And then the president gets a chance to get up and kind of give back a little bit. Two of my favorites over the years were Obama and George W. Bush. Both lots of self-deprecating humor, and Obama was particularly great at it. And so last night, It was Joe Biden's turn. And when we come back here after the break, we'll have some clips of what Joe Biden said last night at the White House Correspondents' Dinner. We'll talk about that. Also talk a little bit about wages in America. Today is May 1st, and many people celebrate that by focusing on worker rights, worker pay. What do you think? Do you make enough? Do you think workers make enough? Or do you think employers are paying too much out? We'll talk about that as well. 715-388-7155. Call and join us. This is the Todd Allbaugh Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network. Justin Timberlake on a first of May morning. It's gonna be May. And here we are. It is May. May 1st, 2023. Welcome back in to the Todd Allbaugh Show on the Civic Media Radio Network, along with Mr. Aaron Zommers, our producer and engineer. Yes, it feels like not so much May, but on the calendar it is. I'm going to go to Kara Foster now from Weatherology on the phone with our forecast update. Let me put it to you this way. As Craig Kilborn, one of the old hosts of the Late Late Show on CBS, was fond of saying, Kara Foster, what up?
I like it. Simple, to the point.
Welcoming. What is going on with this? It's not your Justin Timberlake. It's going to be May forecast.
No, it's definitely not. I know. That's one of my favorite memes of all time, but it's going to be May thing. But it definitely does not feel like May, which I totally get. But this week is very May-like. The rest of it will be.
Very good.
Today is just kind of the leftovers of April. We can blame April for this. I mean, it's all April's fault. And soon it will be over. There's just a lot of wind out there. That's the main thing. But we can thank the wind for not only drying us out, but it's quickly pushing whatever is left of this kind of system that was moving in throughout the overnight hours and that the eastern portion of the state is still looking at this morning. So we can thank the winds at least for kind of just shoving it out, for the last day here. And then we'll be in the clear from here on out. So we can at least know that. Today, we're not anywhere near our average high, which is about the lower to mid 60s throughout the state. We're reaching 50 and staying cloudy in Amory. Winds are about 15 to 20 out of the north, gusting as high as 40. Some leftover rain and snow showers are possible in Wausau today, still reaching 40. North wind still gusting up to 40 there. And then same in Richland Center, there's some kind of leftover rain showers early on today, cloudy with a high of 50. Northwest winds gusting as high as 40 as well. Now tonight, the winds will linger, but all of the showers stop. Partly cloudy 33 in Amory. The winds will linger, gusting as high as 30. Mostly cloudy 32 in Wausau. North winds gusting up to 40 there. And then same thing in Richland Center. Cloudy 36. Northwest winds gusting up to 40. Tomorrow, we'll kind of have some leftover winds, but we're slowly improving. We'll start to see mid-50s, mid-50s tomorrow, some sunshine. The northwest winds will still be gusting in the morning, but then by Tuesday night, we should be kind of clearing up, drying out, and also calming down for sure. So then by Tuesday, we're back in the 60s. We're going to be very sunny. It's going to be very gorgeous. No winds there at all either. Thursday is when we do start to see a chance for some rain showers, but we're still seeing a mixture of sunshine in there as well. And it's going to be very, very spotty showers as of right now. The models are going to be very, it's going to be like one cloud here, one cloud there, and then everywhere in between will be sunny, mid-60s, mid to upper 60s even. And then that will basically continue into Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. But we do continue to get warmer. We're going to be upper 60s, mid to upper 60s Friday, Saturday, and then even in the 70s in most areas as we head into next Sunday. just with that dash of rain possible there. I will say there will be probably a section of rain that's probably going to be more, you know, showers, thunderstorms, maybe a little more consistent than the rest of it. But I think that doesn't come until Sunday evening, maybe even next Monday morning. So it's not going to be a total washout for the next few days. But yeah, we're slow. We're turning a new leaf. It's definitely going to be May, and it is May. And it will eventually start feeling that way. So I promise. I'm meteorologist Garrett Foster.
All right, Karen, we have it queued up, Aaron. Not today, but by the end of the week, Aaron, what's it going to feel like? What's it going to be?
Guess what? It's going to be May.
There you go. Kara Foster with Kara Foster with It's going to be May forecast by the end of the week. By the end, just hang on. Yes. That's all we're asking
hang
for.
Hang on.
All right. As the other boy band once said, bye, bye, bye. We'll talk to you tomorrow, Kara. Thank you.
Catch you then.
Bye, bye. It's boy band day here on May 1st.
Not too bad I didn't have that one queued up.
Right. Well, you know. Things that pop into Todd's head at 8:37 on a Monday morning. That's the key, right? Just hang a couple more days here of chilly temperatures, snow in some parts of the state, and then upper 60s to 70 and sun by the weekend.
Eventually we'll get there.
Right.
By the way, I have to retract a statement I made earlier.
All right. Give it to us.
Irvin Kershner is not the only non-George Lucas director.
Really?
I completely forgot. Return of the Jedi was not directed by George Lucas.
And who was it?
Richard Marquand.
I'm sure it is.
Yep. So just in case anyone was like, Aaron, you idiot. You know nothing about Star Wars. You're right.
Well, no, he knows a lot about it. He knows a lot. Hey, we can't all know everything. That's why we got Google. As my former boss likes to say, Google it up. Very good. Well, yes, a Return of the Jedi, as Mr. Sommer said earlier, back in the theaters. Not only is it's going to be May week, it is May the 4th be with you week. May 4th, Thursday. We'll have to do a few Star Wars themed things for
sure.
Thursday. Yeah. Maybe I'll get out a couple of cinnamon bun rolls and put them on my head and as a Princess Leia costume.
Put it on the side of your headphones.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, it is May 1st here, and talking about a couple of things in terms of May Day, as we are talking about at the top of the show here, it's May Day, it's also International Workers Day, known as Labor Day in some countries. Of course, our Labor Day isn't until later on in the fall, or early fall. Other countries are often referred to as May Day. It celebrates as a celebration of laborers and the working class that is promoted by international labor movement and occurs every year today on May 1st. Traditionally, the 1st of May is the date of the European Spring Festival of May Day. In 1889, the Marxist International Socialist Congress met in Paris and established the Second International as the successor to the earlier International Working Man's Association. They adopted a resolution for a great international demonstration in support of working class demands for the 8-hour workday. Remember, that hasn't always been a thing. If you work for someone, they set the rules. There were no laws that said you could only have a certain number of hours per day for people that work for you. The 1st of May date was chosen by the American Federation of Labor to commemorate a general strike in the United States, which had begun on the 1st of May in 1886 and culminated with the Haymarket Affair 4 days later. The demonstration subsequently became a yearly event. The 1904 Sixth Conference of the Second International called for an all-social democratic Big D party, organizations and trade unions of all countries to demonstrate energetically on the 1st of May for the legal establishment of the 8-hour day, for the class demands, and for universal peace. So I think this is an important thing again, our friend Matt Flynn likes to say, you're not woke if you don't know history. And history is important, right? So when you hear things like, from history, socialist, Marxist, you think, oh my gosh, that's commie stuff, as Matt Flynn likes to say. Well, then you ask yourselves, what do you feel? How do you feel about the 8-hour workday? If you're a plumber, if you're an electrician, if you're on the job, if you work retail, how would you feel about your employer saying, no, you know what? you got to work a 12 or 15 hour day or you get fired. You'd walk out. You'd say you're crazy. But there were people that had to come before us to get us the rights to the laws that are established now to make working conditions favorable for the worker.
And we can never forget that it was an arduous, a bloody process.
Yeah.
And
absolutely. It was, yeah. it was for many generations. It was, if you were the boss, the owner, you set the rules no matter what. Workers had no rights, or at least very few. Because if you couldn't handle the job, or if you passed out, you died in the job, there is somebody waiting to take your place. It's a very class, from class up to down system. The 1st of May, or May Day, is a national public holiday in many countries. In most cases, as International Workers' Day or a similar name, some countries celebrate a Labor Day, quote-unquote, on other dates significant to them, such as in the United States and Canada, which celebrate Labor Day on the first Monday in September. In 1955, the Catholic Church dedicated the 1st of May as St. Joseph the Worker. St. Joseph is the patron saint of workers and craftsmen, among others. So even the church recognizes May 1st as a time for laborers. So the question to you this morning, do you feel that you, or if you don't want to talk about yourself, do you feel that workers in general are making enough money? Do you think the salaries are fair? And if you're an employer or you know an employer, do you think that employers are paying out too much? 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. Would love to hear from you this morning. I've been on both sides of the coin. Been a worker, a laborer, more than I've been an employer or a business owner. But done it twice. Either running my own business or helping run a business. And I think, I would hope that most people, if not all, that worked for me, I would hope they would say I was at least fair, if not a generous boss and employer. You know, my family would say perhaps I was too generous, which is why I am no longer a business owner. You know, because I just always believed in putting the people that worked for me first. I always believed in, I want to treat people like I would want to be treated. That's just the way I am. Just the way I wanted to run the business. My first business I owned, I didn't even take a salary. If we had a little extra money left, I'd cut myself a check for gas or supplies. But I wanted to make sure the workers got paid. But I had been a manager for people who ran businesses. And I get the employer, especially in today's modern world. You have to carry so much insurance because you have to be always concerned about being sued. Not just for the employees, but for your business, to protect the business. You know, cost of labor. If you're a good employer, offer health care for your workers and other benefits, that's expensive for the business owner as well. And if you don't make money in a business, if you're not in the black on the ledger at the end of the month, if you're constantly in the red, you're not going to be in business very long. So in order to keep that business going, and if you're going to be an employer who pays a fair salary, that means you have to charge a certain amount for the goods and services that you provide. I don't care whether that's a plumber. I don't care whether that's a restaurant owner. You know, pick your business. So then it becomes us as American consumers, Wisconsin consumers, are we willing to pay enough for the goods and services so that the employer can pay the employee a fair, livable wage?
And then, of course, we have to get paid more in order to afford those things.
It's a circle. Absolutely. But that's where now we as consumers have to be willing to pay a fair price for goods, that's where it becomes tricky. Because it's easy for us to sit there and say, well, you know, Joe and Jane, you know, who own that business, they should be paying their workers more. All right. We'll pay their workers more, they say. But now you're going to have to pay more for that meal when you come into our restaurant. or more for the landscaping, or go right down the list. And then people get their bill and say, well, that's outrageous. I'm not paying that. That's way too much money. One of my favorite things with my, and God bless all four of my grandparents, I was blessed to know them. But I always got a kick out of, you know, in the 90s, when they get a, you know, they have to pay for something, they say, why? That's way too much money. You know, I back in 1960, I paid, you know, whatever, a quarter for that or half of that. Well, yes. Yes, that was 30, 40 years ago. Prices, the cost of doing business doesn't stay the same. So I see both sides of it. In general, though, are workers being paid enough? 715-388-7155. Again, 715-388-7155. Give us a call. Talk about that. Also talk about Joe Biden's comment at the White House Correspondents' Dinner after this. This is the Todd Allbaugh Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome back to the Todd Allbaugh Show. It's now 8:50 on a Monday morning, May 1st, 2023, along with Mr. Aaron Zommers, our producer engineer. Happy to be with you on a Monday. Over the weekend, it was the White House Correspondents' Dinner. Article in the New York Times this morning talking about it. Whatever news gods decide that the cable television stars Tucker Carlson and Don Lemon should be fired the same week that President Biden was scheduled to give a funny speech ribbing the news media, certainly were generous in providing fresh material. And Mr. Biden took advantage on Saturday night as he gleefully mocked some of his favorite foils. The annual White House Correspondents' Dinner, if you don't know, it's what a time when the news media, particularly those who cover Washington, come together for a big dinner. Politicians in Washington come. The president usually is expected to attend, and people get up and rib the sitting president of the United States, doesn't matter whether it's Republican or Democrat, and then the president has a chance to get up and kind of give it back to him. And Joe Biden, pretty good sense of humor. A lot of self-deprecating humor. Biden's known for kind of a sly tongue. You know when they signed the Obamacare bill, remember? He got caught on mic telling Obama, you know, this is a big effing deal. Only he didn't use the word effing. He actually used the word, which I thought was fantastic. I mean, just, it showed, that's the way he is, right? We all got that uncle or that grandfather or whatever. Uses a little coarse language, but we love him because we know it's just the way they talked. That's kind of the way Joe Biden is, you know? He's just who he is. So in his annual appearance at the Black Tie White House Correspondents' Dinner, the one night of a year, the president is expected to play stand-up comic. Mr. Biden made the most of the opportunity with some timely skewering of those who usually skewer him. Most notably, Fox News, which fired Mr. Carlson on Monday, just days after settling a defamation lawsuit for $787.5 million.
I'd call Fox honest, fair, and truthful. But then I could be sued for defamation.
There you go. Biden started that comment by saying, last year, your favorite Fox News reporters were able to attend the dinner because they were fully vaccinated and boosted, Mr. Biden said in a nod to his coronavirus response strategy. Quote, this year, with that $787 million settlement, they're here because they couldn't say no to a free meal. I thought that was pretty good. And then he just followed
That's
up
pretty
with,
good.
And then he followed up with the cut that the Aaron just played there. Mr. Biden also went after CNN. Just 5 days after the financially struggling network fired Mr. Lemon following comments the woman in her 50s is past her prime. The president continued, and here is the cut of the Don Lemon joke.
You say I'm ancient. I say I'm wise. You say I'm over the hill. Don Lemon would say that's a man in his prime.
That actually is, I like that.
Very good.
I like that a lot. He said his age was a legitimate issue. He said, quote, it's on everybody's mind. And by everyone, I mean the New York Times headline, Biden's advanced age, a big issue. Trump's, however, is not. That's a great point, right? that was absolutely fantastic. Also, he didn't leave anybody out. as he went after Marjorie Taylor Greene a little bit. Here's that cut.
I want everybody to have fun tonight, but please be safe. If you find yourself disoriented or confused, it's either you're drunk or Marjorie Taylor Greene.
I like that. That's good. Also, talked a little bit about the First Amendment. Again, joking about his age, here's President Biden at the White House Correspondents' Dinner over the weekend.
I believe in the First Amendment, not just because my good friend Jimmy Madison wrote it.
Talking about, of course, one of the founding fathers, James Madison, making a joke that he's so old that he actually knew the founding fathers. That was pretty good. But perhaps the favorite one of the night, for me at least, he went after Florida Governor Ron DeSantis.
After his reelection as governor, he was asked if he had a mandate. He said, hell no, I'm straight.
And that one's very good. Very good.
I'm straight. That was really good. I'm not sure who wrote those for him, but, you know, not bad at all. Joe Biden, you know, he delivers them okay. The dinner came to an end of a chaotic week for the media as the chattering classes descended on Washington from their annual ritual of schmoozing, drinking, and gossiping. The industry is reeling from a steady drumbeat of layoffs and closures, but it was the fringe of the two high-profile millionaire cable personalities that had everybody talking. They're talking about Tucker Carlson and Don Lemon. It is the second year since the pandemic, the dinner has mushroomed into an even more splashy spectacle. Like the wedding of a wealthy family, it is now replicated into multiple events spread over 5 days, with the first pre-dinner parties and receptions starting Wednesday night, and the last post-dinner brunches scheduled for Sunday. Now, wait a minute here. I'm all for having a White House Correspondents' Dinner. I think that's great. But turning them into like the Oscars?
Yeah, this is excessive.
That seems a little over the top. Politico's playbook, the newsletter that obsessively covers all things Washington, included spotted at guest lists for 14 events on Friday night, a full 24 hours before the dinner itself. Some of the buzziest parties were hosted by new startups intent on establishing themselves, included Crooked Media, Axios, and Semaphore. So it's kind of, why weren't we there?
That's a good question. I was just going to say there's no Civic Media on that list.
No Civic Media. We'll have to see what we can do next year. Wouldn't that be fantastic?
That would be something.
Here I am attacking the thing, saying it's excessive. And then I'm like, oh, wait, maybe I could go. Because no one enjoys a good party like that more than me, because I love to people watch. So I like to just sit there and watch it all unfold. I don't want to participate. I just want to be there and watch it all unfold.
It's excessive, but if it's already happening.
Yeah, exactly. And it's for a cause. It's for charity. Anything for charity. By the way, I stayed up too late last night, and they replayed Seinfeld on the local CBS station here in Madison, Channel 3, on Sunday nights at 10:30. And they had one of the classic all-time episodes, you know, not that there's anything wrong with that, where Jerry Seinfeld is going to be interviewed by a New York University reporter, and she ends up sitting in the same restaurant in another booth and eavesdropping on George, Elaine, and Jerry's conversation. And Elaine's like, I think she's eavesdropping. And so George starts making up this story that he and Jerry are partners, are gay, just for kicks. Well, it turned, they didn't know that that was the reporter that was going to interview Jerry. And so she starts writing this story, very serious, like, oh, this is really great, whatever. And like, wait, we're not gay. And then the whole running joke of the whole episode is, not that there's anything wrong with that. It's one of the best written Seinfeld episodes. I hadn't seen it in a long time.
I haven't seen it in a long time either.
I stayed up and watched. And actually, it won a GLAAD Award for you know, basically supporting gay issues, because at the end of the show, a guy in uniform says basically, "Hey, thanks for doing that. It gave me the strength to come out and leave the military." So that's when you couldn't be gay and be in the army anymore. Now that's all changed. Thankfully, we have moved forward. We'll move forward with hour number two. Stay with us. This is the Todd Allbaugh Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network.